So for the last case, we have a 32-year-old male that had dysphagic symptomatology since 2017. Edgar scored 3 out of 12, and at the high-resolution manometry, they found a type 2 achalasia.
Hey Ken, you are on air.
Wonderful. What a privilege to be the last case of the day. So I am going to show something different now. And as you know, I am an underwater enthusiast. I've been fascinated by the underwater image, the quality of the image, and I think there are many advantages to underwater imaging. It's actually the natural environment of the GI tract. If you can put now on the screen the endoscopic image, just so you can enjoy this for a moment while I introduce the team. So I have to my right, Alicia. She's an attending here at Humanitas. And then Kiara is a fellow, she's here. And then we have Raisa and our nurse. And it takes a global village, and this village is right here with me, because Raisa is going to do is she's going to help hold my scope in position, and Alicia is going to step on the injection pedal and on the fleshing pedal to relieve as much of my work as possible so I can concentrate on what I'm seeing endoscopically.
Great.
Now, you've seen many POEM cases, and they're all beautiful and so skillful, and I don't expect to improve any results. But endoscopy is not just about the science and the results, but it's also about the art. And we became endoscopists because we enjoy the optics. This is what we love about endoscopy and why we didn't become radiologists. So I try to make every endoscopic journey as enjoyable as possible, and I find underwater accomplishes that. But if you also think about the goal of endosurgery, it is to achieve absolute hemostasis with minimal thermal injury. So I think there are also advantages. So now, do you have the endoscopic image on your screen?
Yeah.
Okay,
can you show
good.
Tunneling?
Yes, so I've already started my tunnel, so I didn't show it to you from the very beginning, but I have turned off the gas, so there's no gas, there's only fluid. Of course, this fluid is saline, so that it provides some conductivity. It is mixed with some methylene blue. What I told Alicia is, we want to keep the submucosa looking blue, and we're doing hydrodissection. The hydrodissection is done with the fleshing pedal. So inject to keep the submucosa blue. Hydrodissection to open the space and to keep the muscularis propria looking pink or pale. So you see the muscularis propria is below. It is sort of pinkish or whitish. That's how we want to keep it. The submucosa is bluish. That's how we want to keep it, and we always want to differentiate. Really pink is up at the top. That's the mucosa. We always want to stay clear of the mucosa. So it's a technique of hydrodissection, submucosal hydrodissection. And Alicia is doing the hard work because she is stepping on the injection pedal and then on the fleshing to keep my view as clear as possible. There are always going to be some bubbles, and I'm doing a constant water exchange. This is just like colonoscopy when we do underwater colonoscopy, where I'm going my full colonoscopy underwater with water exchange. So I'm taking out the old water and putting in new water constantly. So the amount of water that stays in there is minimal. All right, so now let's show the technique. Now the technique is basically a sweeping of your knife. Now what I love about underwater is I see the tip of the knife always. I like the hybrid T-knife because I see the tip and I can use that tip to my advantage when I need it to hook some tissue. But I want to always see the tip. And this is the only issue that I have with some of the other knives where it's more blind. I have to see where the tip of this needle is all the time, where the knife is all the time. So you want to make sure that you're not too far out, but also not too far back. Depending on where you are, you may adjust your position. This is where Raisa helps me, and she will hold this a little bit forward. And now you're going to see the effect of injection, okay? So now, Alicia, inject. So you see how it turns nicely blue, right? And then she will just do a little bit of fleshing. And now this is a little bit of different settings than what I'm used to in my unit, which is using the Vial 300. This is the Vial 3. But it still works. The endocut eye, I'm using endocut eye with the setting. Now, let me just show you here. This is the isolation of the vessels. So the best absolute hemostasis is to avoid any bleeding. And what I hate about ESD and POEM is bleeding. This ruins my day. I start cursing. So I don't want any bleeding. I want to coagulate these vessels before they start to bleed. That's why I don't want to do it blind. So Raisa is going to help hold my scope a little bit here, and I'm going to isolate this position. And by the way, this is a beautiful scope. This is the Fujinon EG760Z, and you see it has different levels of zoom. Now it's out of focus. If you do underwater, you must use a scope that has zoom capability. Now I'm going to go back out, and you can find the optimal zoom with this scope. With the Olympus, which I have, I always do everything in near focus. Also my colonoscopy, everything near focus, because this brings it, the focal point, into perfect position. All right, so now, Alicia, just give one flush, and I'm going to isolate this vessel so you can see it. We just unfortunately have that little air bubble, but I'm using force coag with effect 3 and 100 watts, and I'm just going to hold this up like this and just make this thing turn white like this, right? So that's just a prophylactic. Okay, so now Alicia, just inject and flush. So it's an alternating inject and flush. Now this part here is very simple. It's just sweeping back and forth. I'm just sweeping back and forth like this, and I'm doing constant exchange, water exchange. So the whole idea is that it's very controlled, always under visualization like this, and I want to make sure that my tunnel is sufficiently wide. So I'm just going like this, pushing in like this, and I'm always seeing any new vessels that may come. And Alicia is helping me, Raisa is helping me by pushing, keeping the scope forward. So you see the muscle always stays nice and blanched, pale in the back. The mucosa, the submucosa stays blue. And when the submucosa is no longer looking blue, then we inject some more. So I've trained my nurses to do this for me, and it works very well. So I'm just moving up and down like this, stepping, tapping. With the endocut eye that I use, normally it goes doot, 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 doot. And for some reason, this unit doesn't do this.
From operation time, you think it's a little bit slower than standard technique?
Yes, a little bit slower, maybe, yes. But you get faster and faster. I mean, I'm deliberately showing you each of the isolated steps because there's no need to rush. The most important is to do it under vision and to see very well.
Ken, is the irrigation the standard jet irrigation that comes with the scope, or are there special settings?
Yeah, standard irrigation that comes. You have to have the water jet channel. And this is a little bit different. See, look, there's the vessel, okay? So I'm going to get this guy before, and I don't know why, but I've got this stupid air bubble here, but here's out. So I'm just going to get that guy
first. It looks
first.
Like that. Doing underwater, you use less injection with ivory knife. Is that true?
Maybe. I have nothing to compare it to because I've started underwater from the beginning. So I don't even know how to do this with
you
gas.
Were born underwater.
I do all my poems like this. I do all my ESD like this, too. I do all my ESD like this. So here, hold this. Wait. And then, so Raisa is just holding me in position.
Yeah, I see.
But you see, my muscularis propria always stays nice and... you see the hydrodissection effect, right? The distension.
Okay, in your practice, of course, for sure you have done a couple of patients with the severe fibrosis after balloon dilation or post-surgical.
Yes,
so what is the feeling with underwater with severe
much
fibrosis?
Much better, because you see everything and you dissect with the water. And you see I'm constantly sucking, right? Because we don't want too much water going in. Now, if you have some bleeding here, you go up close, and then you just go like this.
But the severe fibrosis doesn't hinder your ability to do the hydrodissection?
No, actually, it helps me. It helps me. It helps me. Now, when you have that doo-doo-doo-doo-doo, then it goes really much faster. It's sort of going. It's a little bit different. It's interesting that Irby has changed a little bit. So I always like to see the needle tip. So if the needle tip goes out of view, then I make sure that I reposition it.
And so what point are you irrigating through the knife itself, or are you not at all?
I'm sorry? I'm using the knife to pull up. So you can see I'm using my up-down. So there are two techniques, right? There's nauhisas, which is where he just uses his right hand to steer. And I do that some, but I actually feel very comfortable letting go and just turning the dials like this too.
No, but actually, I meant, are you actually using any irrigation through the knife itself, or is all of the irrigation
yes.
through the scope?
Yes. And by the way, it needs to be sometimes suction because the water might come up. So, and also, I do this in the left lateral position, so the water flows out more easily if it does come up. And the other reason is by turning into the left lateral, this way I bring my dissection plane between the 2 and 5 o'clock position, so it's easier to go up and down like this.
Okay, Ken, it's been a beautiful demonstration. We have to close the afternoon. I will leave the procedure on, so if anybody want to stay, can stay and follow you.
Okay,
but I want to thank everybody for staying for this afternoon and see you tomorrow for the last day. Okay, thank you so much.